Rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hands than to be a king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than men's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be a king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from out of the comb. He's all that my hungering spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let him lead than to be a king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
That was great. There's a little pink card in front of you. It's a prayer request. Please, if you have something in your heart, fill that card out and hold your hand up for a deacon. And we'll present it to God at his throne. Wonderful peace. Your hymnals.
Far away in the depths of my spirit tonight rolls a melody sweeter than song. In celestial like strains it unceasingly falls o'er my soul like an infinite calm. Peace, peace, wonderful peace, coming down from the Father. In the fathomless billows of love, what a treasure I have in this wonderful peace, buried deep in my innermost soul, so secure.
Song, can I get you all to stand? Holy, holy, holy. Got a quick message for you. Talked to my best buddy, Doug Jenkins, this morning, and he's doing real well. He'll be back at church next week. Conversed with Pastor Singh, and he said, be sure and give everybody their love, him and his wife, Juanita. So I wanted to pass that along. And our opening song is Holy, Holy, Holy.
Holy, holy, holy.
Would you bow with me in the word of prayer? Loving Father, we thank you so much that we can come here and step away from the activity, if you will, of the world. Father, what a peaceful and enjoying Sabbath day that we can spend together each Sabbath. And Father, we thank you for that Sabbath day. And we ask again that you would bless Jamie George, and I know he blesses us. I remember him from way back because he's been here before, and we so enjoy him. So, Father, be with each one of us. Fill us with the Holy Spirit, and may we enjoy this service as our prayer. And, Father, we pray these things in Jesus Christ's holy name. Amen.
Children, come and listen, come and hear of Jesus' love.
Pick up our lamb's offering, our children's offering. So make sure you are generous for a good cause, and we will gather here for our children's story.
Come and touch our Bible friend, Jesus, Jesus, come and bless us. Come and bless with Jesus' love. Children, children, come and listen. Come and hear of Jesus' love. Children, children, come and see him. Come and see how Jesus loves. Children, children, come and touch him. Come and touch our Bible friend. Jesus, Jesus, come and bless us. Come and bless with Jesus' love.
Good job, you guys. I think one of you at least is going to be a conference treasurer. Praise the Lord. All right. Look at that. Way to go. Praise the Lord. All right. Well, I'm glad you guys are here today. Are you glad to be in church? I'm looking forward to our time together, and I want to tell you something that happened to me a long time ago. But before, I want to ask you a question. And I want you to be honest, all right? Don't worry about, I'm not going to get you in trouble with your parents or anybody else, all right? I want to know how many of you like to clown around and misbehave. Can I see your hands? Okay, there we go. See, if I were to ask that question out here, I'm sure we would have several clowns, see? So now, I was the clown in my class. When the teacher would get up from her chair and she would turn her back on the students and start writing on the board, I would get up from my chair and I would start to make funny faces. Do you want to see what kinds of funny faces I made? Look at my eyes. Look at my tongue. And look at my ears. So the students would start to laugh. They wouldn't pay attention to the teacher anymore. And she would turn around and say, "What happened to my quiet class? You guys need to pay attention to me. This is important. I'm teaching you." And I would disrupt the class every day doing these and other kinds of things. Well, one morning at the beginning of the day, as soon as I arrived, the teacher took me aside and said, "Jamie, I want to ask you for a favor." I said, "What is it?" She said, "I want to ask you not to clown around and misbehave today." And I said, "Why not?" And she said, "Because today I'm taking the class to the zoo." Well, I had never been to the zoo before, so I was pretty excited to hear that. When everybody arrived, they took us to where the bus was. And we got on that bus, And we loaded up and we rode over to the zoo. And we spent the rest of the day at the zoo looking at different animals. Bears, tigers, lions, elephants. And I managed not to misbehave or clown around until 1 o'clock in the afternoon. And at one, we went to a swamp. And that swamp was surrounded by a big fence. Anybody want to guess what kind of animals were inside the swamp? Yes, alligators and crocodiles. And there were some big ones and some little ones. Some of them were swimming in the water. Others were just laying on the grass. Others were even fighting. And for whatever reason, I was amazed at these crocodiles and the things they were doing. And after a few minutes, the teacher said, "Okay, children, it's time to go now to another place where we're going to see other animals." But I wasn't done. I wanted to stay there longer looking at the crocodiles. So the teacher says, "All right, we're going to do what we've done all day, which is we're going to start a single file line. I'm going to be at the front of the line, and I want everybody to get behind me, and we're going to walk together." And so I waited to be at the very end of the line. And so the teacher was at the front and everybody behind her, and she started walking. And she walked fast, and I walked slow. And she walked fast, and everybody walked behind her, and I walked even slower. So after a few minutes of the teacher walking fast and me walking slow, what do you think happened?
You went back to the crocodile.
Yes. She couldn't see me anymore. And when she couldn't see me and I couldn't see her, I turned around and I went back to the swamp. And about three or four of my other classmates that were at the end of the line, they turned around too. And they went with me because they wanted to see what I was going to do. And so I got right up against the fence. And just on the other side lay sleeping one of the biggest crocodiles I have ever seen in my life. And I stood there watching him, and he wasn't moving. It didn't even look like he was breathing. And after a couple of minutes, I thought to myself, wouldn't it be fun to wake up the crocodile? So I started talking to the crocodile. And I said, "Hey, crocodile, wake up." What do you think happened? Nothing happened because he didn't speak Spanish. So I said it louder. I said, "Hey, crocodile, look at me. I'm talking to you." Still nothing. So I said, "What am I going to do to get his attention?" I started looking around and walking around. And over here, I found a stone. And I picked up that stone. And I thought, now this crocodile is going to get my attention. So I put my arm over the fence. And I threw that stone as hard as I could, and boom, it hit the crocodile right on the head. What do you think happened now? Yes, he woke up. And do you think he was happy? No, he was mad. He opened up his big mouth, and he jumped up like this. And everybody got scared, and we all jumped back. Even though the fence was protecting us, we were scared. Well, when I jumped back, nothing happened. I didn't go anywhere. I got pulled right back to where I was. So I jumped again. And I got pulled right back to where I was again. And then I looked, and my foot was stuck. When I went to throw that stone, my foot was right up against the fence. And my body weight shifted forward, and my foot slid down under the fence. And now it was caught by the fence, and there was nothing between my foot and the crocodile. And when the crocodile saw my foot, you know what he thought? Lunch. And I thought, oh no. And I tried to pull my foot out of there. And I yelled out to my friends, "Guys, please come and help me. Help me get my foot out of here." But what do you think my classmates did? They all took off running, and they left me there by myself with this crocodile crawling closer and closer towards my foot. And I began to yell for my mom, "Mommy, mommy, please help me." But my mommy couldn't hear me because she was at home far away. Well, now this crocodile was getting closer and closer, and I was desperate. So I did the best thing that I could do. What do you think that was? Yes, I prayed and I said, oh Lord, please, please don't let this crocodile eat my foot. And I opened my eyes and that crocodile was about to lunge forward and bite off my foot and eat it. But before he did, I felt that something or somebody was pulling me from under my arms and I went flying through the air. And when I landed, I thought, what's going on? So I turned to the right, and I saw my teacher and the zookeeper and other people along with my classmates, everybody running to come and help me. And then I turned to the left, and all I saw was the back of a tall man that was walking away like this slowly. And then I looked at the crocodile, because the crocodile was busy. He was going like this. He had something in his mouth. You know what it was? My shoe. When the man pulled me out, my shoe got caught by a hook on the fence, and my foot came out, my shoe stayed there, and the crocodile bit the shoe. The rest of the day, I walked around the zoo without a shoe. But I was glad that I had my foot. Do you know that the people running back said, yes, now I have two shoes, but I didn't back then. The people that were running back say that all of a sudden they saw this tall man appear behind me. Before the crocodile got to where I was, he pulled me out of there and he set me down on the ground. And then he started walking away like this slowly. And after a few seconds of walking away, they didn't see him anymore. He was gone. I have a pretty good idea who that was. Who do you think that was? Well, who does Jesus send to help us? I think God sent an angel that day to deliver me. And I learned two very important lessons. And this is the part I want you guys to remember. Number one, when your parents, teachers, pastors ask you to do your homework, your chores, your studies, what should we do, guys? That's right. We should pay attention. We should be obedient. We should do it because they love us and they know what's best for us. The second thing I learned that day is that Jesus is our best friend. And we don't have to wait until we're in trouble to talk to Jesus. We could talk to him at any time. How do we talk to Jesus? By praying. We can thank him for loving us, for giving his life so we could have salvation. And for being our best friend. So the next time you guys think about doing something you're not supposed to do, remember the hungry crocodile. Because sometimes we can get in a lot of trouble when we do things we shouldn't do. Thank you for being so attentive, and you can go back to your seats now.
Good morning. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. Psalms 118:8.
Okay, today's offering is for the kindergarten through 12 scholarship fund. And this is a fund which is used to subsidize, to help kids go to our church schools. If you want to give to that, if you would mark it on your tithe envelope as K-12 Scholarship Fund. I'd like to read you a short poem here by Grace Snow Crowell. Helps us remember what we need to be remembering, I think. If I can put a new hope within the heart of one who has lost hope, if I can help a brother up some difficult long slope that seems too steep or tired feet to go, if I can help him climb into the light upon the hill's far crest, I shall be grudged no time or strength that I can spend, for well I know how great may be his need. If I can help through my darkened hour, I shall be glad indeed. For I recall how often I have been distressed, distraught, dismayed, and hands have reached to help and voices called, they kept me unafraid. If I can share this help that I have had, God knows I shall be glad. And as we're giving our offering today, let us remember the help that has been given us and be glad. Father in heaven, we're thankful for all you've given us, for your love and care. We're thankful for these gifts, and we ask that you help us share those gifts that you've given us with others, that your love may spread through our gifts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, church family. I have a fistful of prayer requests. I'll try to go through them as quickly as I can. Forgive me if I mispronounce things. Marge Feldman, it says, Evelyn had a stroke. Please pray for her recovery. Cindy says, please pray for my neighbor, Max. He found out that he has cancer. Art and Jan Peterson, our friend Shannon Grossi, is having brain surgery on Monday, a tumor the size of a golf ball. Let's please pray for her. John, prayer request for his daughter, Brianna. Salvation, parents' salvation. Cousin Sarah has cancer, needs salvation, and possible healing if it's God's will. Beulah says, good health for my sister, Phyllis. Thomas says, Lord, you know the brother that told me he needs the Sabbath off. Please talk to his boss for him. We all know how tough that is. Eva Lundy says, prayers for my uncle and Aunt Georgia, who are in poor health. Prayers for Nate and his family to have strength and encouragement in the difficult times they face. Prayer for healing for Andrew Doyle, Thank you, God, for the beautiful creation he has made and the blessed Sabbath. Tammy says, continuous prayer for our church and the coming meetings. Also, a praise report for continued healing. I can't pray for Art. I'm sorry. Marissa says, Lord, I thank you for this pain in my hands because you helped me get a job for them to hurt. Please pray for Ryan Turner and keep him safe. If you can, where you will, if you'll bow down with me, we'll say a prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you on this beautiful Sabbath day. And Lord, we bring forth a bunch of hurting people. Lord, a lot of people with cancer, a lot of people that are just hurting and ill. Lord, be with them all. Lord, we cannot wait for heaven where there will be no more sickness or sorrow. But while we're here, Lord, strengthen us. Bring us closer to you. Be with this service today. May it bring us all closer to you. Be with Jaime as he brings music, and make it be, or help it to be a blessing for all of us, Lord. Thank you again for all the blessings that you've given us. Thank you for this Sabbath day. Thank you for each and one that are here, and especially be with those that can't be here today. In your name we pray. Amen.
Lord, how about some sound? All right. Let there be sound. Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord today? I sure am. This song is a reminder that even though we live in a world full of nothing but tragedy, sorrow, pain, disappointment, we have a God that is our mighty fortress. And I'm excited to be with you today and share this service that I believe is a bit like what church in heaven is going to be like. What do I mean? I believe that the reason why preachers are long-winded are because when they get to heaven, they're going to be out of a job. There will be no more sermons when we get to heaven. You know what we're going to be doing? We're going to be singing. We're going to be playing our instruments. We're going to be sharing our testimony. And we're going to be letting others know what God has done for us. And now we have this opportunity to take time away from the busyness of life and come to a garden, a place where we can worship God. And this song is a reminder of that.
Thank you.
The title of the message part of our sermon or service this morning is, as you can see up there on the sides, If God Can Use Me, He Can Use You. And I would add to that, He can use anyone that's willing to be used by Him. And I want to share with you a personal story to make that point and hopefully encourage all of us as we face some of the different challenges in our life journey. But first, I want to back up to the year 1997, 20 years ago. That was the year that I got married. And I'm certain that when people get married, the last thing they think about or plan on is something going wrong. Why do I say that? Because weddings are about the celebration of the most powerful force in the universe, which is love. And so we want to enjoy and we want to celebrate that and we want to remain in that feeling, but not just a feeling, but experience. But you know, something did go wrong. And 7 years later, we got divorced. And I went through, by far and large, the most painful and difficult years of my life. I remember days when I couldn't even get out of bed. The phone would ring and I would let it go to the answering machine because people were calling to find out what was the latest scoop. Days would go by and I didn't eat and I didn't notice and I didn't really care. And then I would get up to do concerts, get up on the stage, and I'd begin to play, and then I would talk. And at times it felt like somebody was standing behind me and whispering into my ear, "What are you doing up here? How can you be talking to people about Jesus when your life is a mess and you're a bad example?" And I started wondering, maybe should I just do something different? Should I stop playing the violin? And I struggled with it, and I almost gave it all up. I remember I was in a big church in Oregon. In today's vernacular, we call that a mega church. Have you seen them on television? With the big light shows, the laser machines, the smoke coming out. They had invited me to put on the service, basically, that morning. And the band was up on the stage. The people were up on their feet singing. The pastors were seated at the platform. And it was my turn to be there and go up next. But I was in the bathroom in a side room near the stage. And I was crying. And I was literally shaking because I thought to myself, if I go out there, people are going to see right through me, and I'm going to fall apart, and I can't do that. And I thought, but what do I do now? He can't just leave. And I thought, where's my violin case? I need to just make a run for it. I'm going to put my violin away, run out of here, and that's it. I'm done. I'm never going to play the violin again. And as I was about to open the door of the bathroom, I heard a voice that said, "Go out there and talk to them about me, because it's not about you." And God did something really awesome that day to touch and reach the lives of many people. And as time went by, God healed my heart. It took a long time, but it finally happened. And in May of 2012, about 5 years ago now, it was Mother's Day weekend, and I had planned my concerts close to the area where my mother lives in Charlotte, North Carolina. And so I had several concerts starting Friday night, and the last one ended at noon on Sunday. And afterwards, I went to her house, I picked her up, I took her and my sister out to lunch, and we spent the rest of the day and evening together. And we had a wonderful time, especially our conversation during lunch. And I remember one of the things that I said to my mother was this, "Mom, I am never going to get married again. It was too painful. It wasn't worth it. In fact, I've decided that I'm going to marry my violin."
She has nice curves. And she only talks back when I tell her to. My mother waited till I finished, and then she says, well, son, you can do whatever you want, but don't limit God if he wants to do something else in your life. And I thought, you know, that sounds just like my mother. You know, apparently God did want to do something else. 2 years prior to that, I had been in Washington, D.C. for a weekend of concerts. And at the end of one of the concerts, as I went to the back to greet people, a young lady with a beautiful smile came to say hello. And she simply said this, I was really moved by the music and the message that you shared tonight. And she took a CD and then she walked maybe 10, 15 feet away from where the table was, because there was a small group of what I presumed were her church friends. And so she started talking to them. I greeted other people as they came by. And when things kind of quieted down, I caught wind of the conversation they were having. And so I went to join the conversation briefly, then returned to the table as more people came by. And that was it. 4 months later, as I was looking on Facebook, I found Rochelle's profile as the friend of a mutual friend, and I sent her a friend request. I recognized her photograph. And we exchanged a couple of brief messages. How are you doing? How are things going? And one of the things she said to me was, I have a sister that lives in Atlanta, and she has two young children, and I try to go visit her every, you know, few months, because they grow up so fast that I want to be a part of their lives, and I'm getting ready to go. And I said, really? Well, I live in Chattanooga, and that's not too terribly far from Atlanta. Why don't you let me know the next time you're going? And if I'm around, maybe we can get together. And she said, well, that'd be great. So she sent me the date, and I looked at my calendar, and I was going to be home. So at that point, I went to her Facebook page, because I wanted to learn about her. I wanted to find out what kinds of things she did, she enjoyed, so that I may recommend an activity or even a restaurant that would be to her liking. And as I looked at her photo albums, I saw a common denominator: sports. This girl loved sports. There were pictures of her playing volleyball, pictures of her running races. She had even run a marathon. But it wasn't just that. Rochelle had been into sports in a very serious and organized way, because for 11 years, she had been a professional women's football player. I didn't even know that the sport existed until I saw these photographs. She had been a star linebacker and running back. As a running back, she rushed for 14,000 yards. She was a two-time Super Bowl equivalent champion and MVP. And when I saw this photograph, I was disturbed, because I thought to myself, am I going to be number 86 if I do something she doesn't like? And so I thought, she likes sports. Let's do sports. So I wrote to her and I said, listen, when we get together, would you like to go jogging? And she said, I would love that. And can I invite you to a Bikram or hot yoga class after our jog? Now, before anybody here calls the conference office, please give me a chance to explain to you what Bikram or hot yoga is, because there is no meditating in hot yoga, because it's too hot. All right? I had always heard that yoga is not something that Christians should do, because sometimes they incorporate this meditation thing into it. And so I thought, well, if anything weird happens, I'm going to walk out of the class. I wasn't going to see her till Friday morning, and I got home from my weekend of concerts Sunday night, a few days before, so I took this opportunity to train and prepare for our jog. Every night, I jogged up and down my neighborhood, and I jogged for 5 miles. And by Thursday night, I could tell that I was really feeling good, because I was jogging 5 miles in an hour. Until somebody said to me recently, dude, I fast walk 5 miles in an hour. But I didn't know. And so with confidence, I went to pick her up in the morning, and we go to the park and start jogging. And within about 40 seconds of our jog, I knew I was in trouble,
because if I was jogging a 12-minute mile, she was jogging a 9-minute mile. I had to recalculate and reconfigure my entire jogging plan because I had to now account for sucking enough oxygen to survive this jog. The only thing that threw a monkey wrench into my newfound plans is that while we jogged, Rochelle wanted to talk. She would run off a string of sentences like she was just walking in the park, and then she would ask me a question. I tried to limit my responses to just, yes. As I get to the end of the third mile, she looks at me and she says, Jaime, I feel good. Do you want to run a fourth mile? And I looked at her and I said, yes. But we're going to miss our hot yoga class. And she says, you're right, we don't have time. And I thought to myself, praise the Lord. So we stop and we go over to the studio. I told you I'd never been inside a yoga studio before, so I was really concerned. But I had more to be concerned about with the heat. It was 110 degrees and 70% humidity inside that room. And we spent 90 minutes doing nonstop muscle stretching, heart pumping exercises. I was covered in sweat from head to toe. I lost 1,500 calories in those 90 minutes. At the end of the 30th minute, I could barely understand what the instructor was saying. I was starting to get confused and dazed. At the 60th minute, I remember looking up, and I thought the heavens were parting and Jesus was coming back. It was just the steam rising. It was getting hotter in there. At the 90th minute when the class ended and I laid on my mat, I was covered and surrounded by a pool of my own perspiration. The room was spinning. I was dazed. I was dehydrated. I was exhausted. And as I drove back to Chattanooga after that, I was upset with myself for having even tried this. And I mumbled to myself as I drove away. I said, I can't handle this chick. And so I didn't speak to Rochelle for a year and a half after that. 18 months went by. And then one day, I looked on Facebook, and on the news feed, a photograph of Rochelle had come up. She was on vacation, and she had taken a photograph doing one of the same postures that had nearly cut me in half a year and a half before. And I had such a visceral response that I got on my mobile phone, and I sent her a text message, and I said, I hope you're having a good time. But you can't read tone in text. And she read, I hope you're having a good time. And she texts back, I am. I hope you are too. And then I thought, well, wait a minute. I'm going back to Washington, D.C. in a couple of months. So I sent her a message. I said, listen, I'm going to be in your area. I'd love to invite you to one of the concerts. And if you have time, are you up for going for a jog and then going to a Bikram class? And then I thought, what have I just done? Well, she had time. And so all of those things happened that weekend. And when the weekend was over, I went home. And I got home Monday night and I rang her on the phone and I said, listen, Rochelle, I don't know what you think of me or if you even think anything, but I'm going to pursue you until you tell me to go away. And so every day for the next 2 weeks, we would text back and forth for a few minutes. It was a very busy time. I had a concert coming up Thanksgiving weekend, and I found out that she was going back to Atlanta to see her sister. And so I invited her to come to the concert. And the morning after the concert, we sat down to talk. And I said, listen, I got to be honest with you. I've been a failure at my relationships in the past, and I don't want to keep making the same mistakes I've made before. I don't want to be in a relationship only to find out that it's not working and it's not going to work. I would rather find out beforehand if things are going to work or not. So I have a list of questions. If you answer them correctly, we can keep talking. She wasn't fazed by that. She pulled out a notebook from her purse and she said, I have a list of questions for you too. So one asked and the other one answered and we went back and forth. And when we finished, we prayed and we said, Lord, if this is your will, please open the doors and if not, close them. We don't want to do something that isn't your will. 2 weeks later, we started dating. 2 months after that, we got engaged. And 5 months after that, we got married. And as I stand here today, I can promise you that I had given up, completely given up on the thought that I would ever experience this kind of joy, peace, and love again. But you see, we serve a God that doesn't know the meaning of the word impossible. And what concerns him is not so much what we've done and where we've been, but what he can do if we allow him to be in control of our lives. And I don't know if you're here today and you have a broken heart, a broken home, a broken bank account, a broken car. But I want to invite you to do the first right thing, which is to bring that problem before the Lord. Now, I don't know what God is going to do. I don't know if he's going to remove that mountain, that obstacle, a little, a lot, or at all. But I can promise you that not only will he walk with you, he will carry you every step of the way until the end. Now, I still had to worry about marrying a football player. So before we got married, I made a promise to the Lord that I would always do everything she says. And as a result, these have been the best nearly 4 years of my life. When she said, "Honey, could we get married at the beach?" I said, "Of course." And when I'm home during the week and she says, "Darling, the dishes are dirty, the trash needs to be taken out, the floors need to be swept and mopped," I say, "Baby, you don't have to say another word. I got it." Because I believe in the expression, happy wife, happy life. It is the Savior that came to this world to give his life so that we could have it, that also wants us to have life and have it abundantly. It is about him that this next song talks about. Michael Card wrote what is the most popular contemporary Christian song of all time, El Shaddai. He's here by way of video, and he and I are going to do a duet for you of El Shaddai. Hope you enjoy it.
Okay, if you clapped, you have to sing.
El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Elyona Adonai. Age to age, you're still the same. By the power of the name, El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Erekim Kana Adonai. We will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai. Through your love and through the ram, you saved the son of Abraham. And by the power of your hand, turn the sea into dry land. And to the outcast on her knees, your might, you set your children free.
Ready?
El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Elyona Adonai. Age to age, you're still the same. By the power of the name, El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Kana Adonai. We will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai. And through the years you made it clear that the time of Christ was near. Though the people failed to see what Messiah ought to be, and though your word contained the plan, they just could not understand. Your most awesome work was done through the frailty of your son. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Elyona Adonai. Age to age, you're still the same. By the power of the name, El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Erechim Kana Adonai. We will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai. We will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai.
Well, as we get ready to wrap up our service this morning, I want to, well, first apologize a little bit for going over. And I say a little bit because when our favorite sports team is playing and goes into overtime, nobody usually says, that's it, I'm done, right? So if we're going to be in the house of the Lord, and that's the place where we're going to be a little late, I think it's all right. I want to thank the pastor and the church for the opportunity to be here. Thank you, Pastor, for having me once again. May the Lord continue to bless you, Bonnie. God continues to have a part in this church's mission. The church is not this beautiful property, this building. It's you. And He calls you to be a beacon of light right here in this community. And if you're visiting, I want to thank you for being here today. And I want to acknowledge a couple of friends of mine that are here, Don and Betty Gonzalez. I've known them for a number of years, and I'm so thankful to see you guys and glad that you have been kind enough to attend so many of my concerts over the years. I'm thankful for your friendship, and I also want to acknowledge somebody that's like my sister and her parents that are here, Ilsa and Elder and Mrs. Nation, who have served the Lord for many, many years faithfully. They're here. It's wonderful to see you and be with you. One of the things that I love about what I do is that I get to see my friends and spend time with them, and oftentimes it's never long enough. And one of the things that I hate about what I do is that I have to say goodbye. But when we get to heaven, we're never going to have to say goodbye again. And I want to thank our AV team as well for doing a fantastic job. And I want to thank our deacons and ushers for the help. The last thing I want to share with you before our closing song is that about 4 years ago, almost five now, I felt the Lord impressing me to found a charitable organization. For a number of years, for many, many years, I have worked with many different organizations and ministries, wonderful ministries like It Is Written, Voice of Prophecy, Amazing Facts, and so forth and so on. But I felt the Lord nudging me to do certain mission type and evangelistic work around the world. And so we founded Healing Music. And the reason why we called it Healing Music is because as I have traveled around the world for the last 30 years now, I have seen how music can open the hearts of people and prepare the way for the Holy Spirit to work. I've been to countries like Russia, Ukraine, Czechoslovakia, Romania, China, my native country of Cuba, Latvia, and others, where in some cases they discouraged the public preaching of the Word of God, and in others they made it downright illegal. And so what we did was use music to bring people to Jesus Christ. We would organize concerts in different venues. People would come and fill these venues because in these countries they love good music. And I would begin playing classical music. And halfway through I'd begin then to play gospel songs and hymns and spirituals. And sometimes these folks had never heard these melodies and hymns before. And they sat there spellbound because the music grabbed their attention. Sometimes all we could do was share with them some literature. But there were times when I felt impressed. I had to share with them what God had done in my life. And so I'd begin to tell them my testimony. And then I would make an invitation at the end for people to give their hearts to the Lord. And folks would stream forward. and I'd talk to them, get to know them, and pray with them. And sometimes somebody would say, "Sir, I am an undercover police officer. The government sent me here to make sure that nobody talked about Jesus. But God has touched my heart and I've given my life to Him today." That's the power of godly music. In India, we're going to the slums, the streets, the countryside. In Nepal, in Bangladesh, in Myanmar, we're doing the same thing. And we're rescuing orphan and needy children. And we're putting them in Christian schools and orphanages. And we're giving them clothing. We're giving them beds. We're giving them a roof over their head. We're giving them food to eat. We're giving them instruments so that they can learn to praise God with their talents. We're giving them a Christian education so they can have hope and share that hope with others. And this flag is the flag of my native country of Cuba. This flag has stood for oppression and persecution for more than 50 years. But by the grace of God, things have changed. The political and the religious persecution that there existed has been somewhat pulled back, especially religious persecution. There's still a lot of political repression. But people can now worship freely and share the love of Jesus. I remember living in the days where if you said Jesus in a public place, you could get arrested and go to jail. My dad as a pastor was threatened and hauled in a number of times and told not to preach anymore. Now, if you like old cars, I can hook you up. There are thousands of these old machines amazingly flying, driving around, riding around in Cuba still. But the problem is that cars aren't the only things that are old in Cuba, as everything is old. Everything is falling apart. Everything is dilapidated. Most people in Cuba make $10 to $15 a month. And so they struggle just to eat. This is the mode of transportation in a lot of places. This is how dozens of people get around sometimes. We use big vehicles as we go around neighborhoods in towns inviting people to come to learn about Jesus. And a lot of folks don't have cars, so they pile on. And they come to church and they learn about Jesus. Now, the government won't let us bring Bibles into Cuba, but they'll sell them to us because they're good capitalists, you see. They'll sell them to us for about $4 a Bible. Last year, we purchased 25,000 Bibles so that people could learn about Jesus Christ. This is the printing equipment at the union office. It's old. It's antiquated. This particular printing press is from 1883. And it's what we use to make Bible lessons. We print Bible lessons on this. It costs $1.50 to print 12 Bible lessons. We have to buy the paper from the government, but when we run out of ink, we have a trick. Most people in Cuba that have cars change their motor oil every 20 to 25,000 kilometers. And when they change the oil, they don't discard it. They save it and they bring it to the printing press. Because after 25,000 kilometers, this oil is so thick and dark that it's perfect on this printing press from 1883. And it works just like ink. So using this used motor oil, we have printed more than 250,000 Bible lesson sets. We have lay pastors. It's hard to build churches. The government won't give permission to purchase buildings or build or properties for it. And so we have hundreds of home churches throughout the island, and we pay our lay pastors $20 a month, and dozens of people come. This is one of our home churches. People come there and they learn about Jesus Christ. This is what churches look like in Cuba. People are hungry for the Word of God. This is what baptisms look like in Cuba. And I just got back Monday night. I spent a week doing evangelistic missionary concerts in four different provinces in Cuba. 52 people gave their hearts to the Lord at these presentations, and many others wanted to study the Bible and learn more about Jesus. Praise God. I want to share with you the story of, in closing, the story of this young lady who was one of our lay pastors. She was 38 years old when I met her. Her name is Lisette. And Lisette is remarkable because she was born with cerebral palsy, but even that hasn't prevented her from not sharing her love for Jesus with others. Her mother has to bathe, feed, change, move her. The sounds that she utters can only be understood and translated by her mother. But she has a passion for God. She does needlepoint. And her mother showed me some of her pieces. And she demonstrated for us. And I said to her, Mom, how can she do needlepoint if she can barely control her movements? And she said, it's hard, Jamie. It takes her hours to do one of these pieces. And she pokes and bleeds. She pokes her fingers and bleeds multiple times. But you see, from the sale of every one of these pieces, she can purchase a Bible for her students. She told me that every day she asks her mom, Lisette does, to put two folding chairs outside their house. They live in a very busy corner. And hundreds of people are walking by every day. And so she carries Lisette out there, puts her in one of these folding chairs, and then as people walk by in this condition that she's in, Lisette calls out to people and invites them to sit next to her in that empty seat. And when somebody sits there, she opens her Bible and she begins to talk to them about Jesus Christ. And when I met Lisette, she had brought 27 people to Jesus. And when her mother told me that, I thought, well, if she could do that, I could do that. If God could use her, He could use me. And He could use you. And my desire as we leave this place today is that we won't just leave ready to have a good time at fellowship lunch or socialize. That we will leave here with a desire, with a burden, with a passion to share the love of Jesus with the people that are around us. And if you're here today and you don't know Jesus, I want to invite you to give your heart to Him. If you've already done so, I want to invite you to seek a closer walk with Jesus. And if you're a young person, I want to challenge you to say, Jamie, I want to dedicate my talents for the glory of God. Because I can tell you that there is nothing this world can offer you. No amount of money, drugs, alcohol, or anything else will give you the peace and the joy that serving Jesus will give you. As I start to play this last song, deacons are going to share with you an envelope that says healing music. And if the Lord impresses you to be a part of what we're doing in Cuba, in India, and other parts of the world, your contribution, whether cash, check, or credit card, is tax deductible. Simply turn in your envelopes at the end of the concert at the doors as you leave. And as you leave the sanctuary, and either you head back home or to the fellowship luncheon prepared, there's a table out here on the right that has a number of our CDs and DVDs, and we have a devotional book. You can, if you'd like, you can take any one of them or all of them on the honor system today. What is the honor system? Especially if you're visiting a Seventh-day Adventist church for the very first time. Well, Seventh-day Adventists keep the Sabbath from sundown Friday to sundown Saturday. And the aim during these hours is to spend in communion with God and in fellowship with one another. So when you get to the table, there's no talk about money. There's no exchanging of money. There's a little form that has two parts. We invite you to fill out the left side of the form and leave it with us. And the right side is perforated. So you tear that off and take it home with you along with your CDs and DVDs and book, because I won't be here this evening. And that right side of the form has our address, our phone number, and our email, so you can take care of it any which way you want. It's called the honor system because it's between you and the Lord whether you follow through or not. Now, I understand that the sun sets at 7:25, so my suggestion is that at 7:26, you follow through. Can I have a witness? I don't think I need to say anything else. Amen. I'm going to just play a cappella since we've run out of time. The song Amazing Grace. And then we're going to have our closing benediction. And we will dismiss. May God bless you. And may you remain in His amazing grace. Thank you. Shall we stand for our benediction? Dear Heavenly Father, we are so thankful today for your amazing grace. Thank you for what you did in sending Jesus to come to this world to bring light, hope, and salvation. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to come to a beautiful church in a beautiful place and worship you freely while so many other people around the world are suffering and dying today for being faithful to you. Lord, may we not take these freedoms and opportunities for granted, but rather may we make the most of them while we still enjoy them so that we can tell others that Jesus loves them and that he is coming soon. Lord, we know that this world has no way of getting fixed, of improving. We know that the only thing that is going to make things better is Jesus coming to take us home. So as we leave here today, may we have in our hearts a burning desire to do what you have given us the opportunity to do in using the talents that are yours to share the love of Jesus with others. May we not feel comfortable, at ease, or rested until every day we do what we can to share Jesus with others. Because we ask in his name. Amen.